immersion into a digital environment and the digital elaboration and analysis of pre-digital survey and legacy landscape studies or site maps has proven to be a fruitful job with constantly improving results. The book edited by Allison in 2008 and especially the work of Rob Witcher on the matter have enhanced the contribution of the approach that seeks to assess the potential of the pre-digital or early digital information producing meaningful data sets out of it. Sometimes, mapping in a digital environment can be the easiest and quickest way to get digital access to pre-digital legacy data, and this can be done even to make much readable and accessible very old and child legacy data, such as written ancient sources and archive information. This way, new life will be given, for instance, to ancient sources mentioning place names in Greece through the topo text application, or to the Greek medieval landscape mapped and analyzed in an early GIS system with the guide of the Ottoman archives, or to the ancient metallurgical workshops related to the silver mines of Lavrion, located and mapped thanks to the reading of an ancient inscription. The process of digital mapping, as we'll see, can be considered a critical point also in the relationship between archaeologists of the past and their legacy and the digital archaeologists of today. We should first separate two fields of investigation. On one hand, legacy data from pre-digital intensive survey. On the other hand, legacy data useful for regional landscape studies. The first pylon includes the legacy survey records, mainly pre-digital or partially digital, as we'll see. The collection information is based on fieldwork, mainly intensive and systematic survey, and partially extensive survey. Information is characterized by data collected in a quite recent past, as systematic archaeological surveys began in the 60s. Therefore, data are much newer than excavations ones, so their legacy can be considered peculiar for several reasons. First, survey methodology has evolved rapidly. We didn't assist to any actual change in methodology as we're working, counting, and collecting. But rather, current surveyors can think reflexively about how their own methodologies impact their data. Furthermore, current surveyors can count on experience on standard methodologies in their field and in data processing applied for decades, along with increased knowledge deriving from comparative studies. The process of digitizing and the use of digital devices in fieldwork increased the standardization and the uniformity of data. Second, often archaeologists whose research produce the data are still active and involved in archaeological research, as you can see in this slide. And some of the legacy data from those projects from the 80s on, even if paper-based, were already digitized and in an embryonic stage. In addition, the digital versions of their data were mainly transpositions of information registered on paper, manually analyzed. The risk is there to underestimate the range and significance of decisions and assumptions involved not only during the original fieldwork but also during the process of digitization. When dealing with areas covered by intensive surface surveys, the main data set is the density of surface potsherds, corrected by several factors. First of all, the visibility on the ground. Space filled between workers needs also to be considered. And critical issues for data biases, as you well know, are fabric definition as well as chronological attribution to potsherds. In the case of the use of chronological categories especially, we should ask ourselves about the degree of representativeness of the data in order to produce reliable period-by-period distribution maps. Past ceramic survey data are often to be analyzed in a joint georeference research environment with recent digital data, DEM, GPS positioning of features, and so on, geophysics, and so on. The second pylon is constituted mainly by legacy datasets useful for diachronical regional landscape studies, which are deeply concerned with the matter of legacy data as they deal usually with large areas where data from different sources need to be analyzed jointly. These are usually multivariate data, heterogeneous, which can include bibliographical data of gazetteers, and various data coming from rescue and systematic excavations to ancient travelers, from surface survey to historical cartography, as we saw. The data sets are characterized by this homogeneity, non-linearity, and incoherence, and are often incomplete, since they were usually collected for totally or slightly different purposes and with no or low technological needs. When dealing with this kind of data sets and the insidious performing of data integration, the process of source criticism, a reflexive archaeological practice, is essential. The particular attention that has to be paid to the interaction of past and present action should go further into an analysis of the interaction of the past and the various presents marked by the different archaeologists, travelers, and scholars interested in the past, who left us their legacy in various forms of elaborated knowledge. Also, in the case of archaeological landscape data, there are several issues that play an important role. The differentiation and classification of sites is still a critical issue. The variable and relative use of chronological ranges used in site dating should be also taken into account while considering the archaeological visibility of a period and while performing meaningful comparisons. Various detection of possible biases, often through digital techniques, have been employed in the reading of legacy data, such as the distance of the archaeological features from modern world networks that can bias the archaeological recovery in the datasets produced. In both pylons, we should stress out here the value of the digitization process of all data. Digitization is a valuable part of analysis and not just the frustrating process of getting the data in. When producing maps, issues such as accuracy in positions and consistency of geometry are of valuable importance both in the digitization of legacy maps and the new produced maps from legacy data. Furthermore, the growing and welcome availability of legacy data in digital formats means that this process is increasingly completed by other people. This means that many digital data also have to be considered legacy. DEM, such as Aster DEM, widely used, aerial remote sensing data, and also any digital product that is much easily available today. These data are legacy, as they are collected by others and without any archaeological purpose. Each one of them carries different issues and bias risks, which need to be analyzed separately. At this point, we ought to mention that the complexity of the landscape palimpsest obviously involves the physical landscape datasets that should be and are involved in landscape studies and archaeological surveys in order to better interpret the data in the taphonomic and post-depositional processes. The landscape character is considered as a result of the association transforming through time between physical landscape zones and activities, even archaeological activities, within a wider region. But how can we assess the value of those legacy data? How can we generate knowledge on landscape, squeezing the best out of this heterogeneous available information? To give an idea, we'll give a start with a reflexive diagram concerning the reflexive loop on archaeological excavation data digitally collected, published in a paper by Bergen and other co-authors. Here, members of the team reflect on the use of digital technology on site to promote a reflexive engagement with the archaeology. They explore how digital data in a fieldwork context can break down communication barriers, foster an inclusive approach to the excavation process, and facilitate reflexive engagement with recording and interpretation. Their diagram attempts to summarize the generation of knowledge at Satalyuk. The main points are a thinkingless site, which will inform the recording digitally performed, where the archaeologist plays the role of an agent, the reflexive loop, always active in the process of knowledge production, which produces information at the travel edge, which went through the loop and returns to the field, being available on the digital devices archaeologists are provided with. With this information in mind, we quickly draw the reflexive diagram readapted and revised for landscape and survey data, surpassing the mere work on the field and taking interest in the entire facet of landscape research. At the very bottom, we have the landscape, and then, as for the pylon of fieldwork survey, the flow will be quite easily available and similar to the excavation process. The knowledge production will produce information at the map's edge, which has gone through the loop and refers to the field, being available on the digital devices field archaeologists are provided with, thanks to the increasing use of GPS and GIS mobile applications. We would need to include in the process relevant metadata, formal metadata, as well as contextual metadata. which define measurements, even categorization, but which can assist understanding. For example, surveyors have a strong influence on results. Similarly, knowledge on local ceramic sequences is incredibly variable and profoundly affects the ability to date material and site and off-site activities. As for regional landscape studies, we can follow the same Freud diagram. Rethinking the landscape, reflexivity in the recording process allows the archaeologist to constantly reassess and reevaluate perception and understanding of the landscape's history, which in turn impacts the recording itself. The reflexive loop, and then information at the map's edge. Information and collected knowledge collated and accessible in the field on GPS and mobile GIS application, as it is generated and updated through a continuous connection to the server, for instance. This facilitates access to a holistic overview of the data on the fly, recursively impacting the recording process. On the other hand, things may get much more complicated here, as research cannot be performed without the involvement of legacy data, the more archaeological information on the area collected in a long time span. The examination of legacy data could be inserted in this part of the diagram, involving interpretation and recording of the information as an intermediate step to be involved in the data production to be inserted into the database, combining description and interpretation as a sort of attachment to the fresh digital data collected in the field. It seems, though, that this option could be a bit restrictive for such a bunch of heterogeneous data that play such an important role. As an alternative, the reflexive loop could be doubled. The content of the red circle, the production of archaeological knowledge through fieldwork, had happened in a moment or several moments of archaeological research in the past for each one of the sources of legacy information we consider. Certainly, the flow would lack the added reflexive value provided by the digital recording and the increased knowledge of archaeologists today. In any case, our confrontation with legacy data is a mandatory step in order to produce archaeological knowledge enriched by fresh collected data. It is our confrontation with the legacy data that produces a reflexive loop, a sort of personal dialogue between real and ideal, between the archaeologist of the present and the archaeologists and surveyors of the past, a mutual dialogue which could increase knowledge. We would suggest a twofold approach. On one hand, that the ongoing interpretation of the increasingly newly connected knowledge goes along with the ongoing interpretation of the old previous knowledge in the same area in a continuous dialogue with what happened in the field. The perception and use of the legacy would continuously change as the fresh knowledge increased through a new, larger reflexive loop outside the red circle. On the other hand, this dialogue should not be one way and once in time. In other words, we shouldn't simply read the information from the various past researches, absorb them into our background of knowledge, and that's it. Or rather, we read the old data once, we incorporate them in our record as a whole bunch, and that's it. Rather, we should consider a model of knowledge production in which the small red circles would multiply. They would be all interconnected, and each of them would be connected with a wider side circle. Therefore, the dashed line, including the legacy as a whole package, should not exist in the reflexive loop, otherwise data would be biased and knowledge reduced. We should aim at the sort of personal dialogue that the archaeologist creates with the several archaeologists, cartographers, and surveyors of the past, with each one of them. This way, in concluding, the loop assumes several dimensions and knowledge increases. The diversity of information should be stressed out, rather than glossing over incompatibilities with the use of digital GIS environments and mobile GIS applications in the field. Such a flexible dialogue would get continuously enriched and so would the degree of perception of archaeologists can have of the landscape palimpsest in its long-term dimension and the memory content the landscape itself carries with it. Thank you. Thank you.